Well, my story, or what I call my journey, began in 1993 when I was giving my granddaughter, who was about 4 months old. That was my first time ever being involved with the child welfare system.
I didn't have any beds for them, and there's no help out there. There's not a whole lot of resources to be able to help you. So it was a struggle. It was a struggle because I didn't have what the kids needed at the time.
We were, as a kinship placement or relative placement, weren't entitled to services. We didn't get resources. Everything was just kind of left on us.
My oldest daughter that we adopted is now 40. Back then, there was no supports at all. It was like adoption, you sign on a dotted line, and this was goodbye. So there was no support. What we did on our own. The things, the trauma that my children had suffered through, I knew nothing about trauma, complex trauma or trauma-informed. We knew nothing about that. We learned as we went. It was hard. It was not easy.
I've been fostering for 9 years, and every year I learn something new. Every child that comes to me, they come with a set of different traumas. What they've been through is always different. So it's a challenge to meet the child where they are.
Yes, I had to change the way I lived. Then now I had 5 kids, and in that, taking care of the 5 kids, I had to go to 3 daycare centers, and then I needed to pick them up after school and cook for them, and it was very, very difficult for me, being already, at that time, I think I was close to 60.
I would say the system fell short in just assuming that because I was the grandmother, everything was okay, that everything was going to be taken care of. And yes, when they bring the children to kinship relatives, they're generally not going to say no because it's their sister, it's their grandchild. And they tend to say yes, even when it becomes a financial hardship for them.
Trying to get the kids everything that they needed for school was a hardship. Getting beds for them was a hardship. Getting car seats.
It's not working. I mean, it's not working. I mean, if something's not working, and you continue to do it the same way, it's still not going to work. It needs to do a new thinking about this. It needs to treat resource parents, foster parents, adoptive parents, kinship parents as equal partners. It has to change.
It's easy to call grandma and say, I have these children and they need a place to go. And the grandmother says yes. The child welfare system needs to also look at, where is grandma? Is she financially? Is she medically? Are these things stable enough for grandma to be able to support these children?
A community of hope, in my mind, looks like somewhere where any person who needs help can go and can get there easily. A place where a person can go to get help in all areas. Whether it's financial help, whether it's mental help, whether it's needing transportation, whether it's needing housing, help for their children.
Or if I reached out to my church, that community, I don't necessarily have to call child welfare to say, okay, my check is short this month, or I only got $2,000, but this month I'm going to need $2,200 because the electric bill went up, and the water bill went up, and the food bill went up.
I have community now. I have people, there's a saying that it takes a village to raise a child. And so building this community with other grandparents, we give each other hope.
Hope, without hope, you have nothing. If you don't have hope, you have nothing to strive for. If you don't have hope, we have to give them hope.